Everyone hated him and loved him, or loved him and hated him, so there was great rivalry.
The whole of the country, you're either a Ovett person or you're a Coe person.
There was the establishment figure of Sebastian Coe. There was the iconoclastic figure of Steve Ovett.
I was 19, kind of wanting to do what they were doing, wanting to be in their shoes, but at the same time thinking, oh, I don't know if I could cope with all of the pressure that they were under at that time.
The Beatles or the Stones, Borg or McEnroe, were you Coe or Ovett? In Moscow in 1980, the whole country was transfixed by middle distance running as Britain's best battled it out over 800 metres. Some said it was good-natured rivalry, others that it ran a little deeper.
Athletically, it was a huge rivalry. I mean, we both knew going to Moscow that we would, our target was to come back with what the other fella wanted.
And the script said the world record holder for 800 metres, Sebastian Coe, was to win the race.
Tremendous roar around the stadium as they go on their way. Three Britons, two East Germans, one Russian, one Brazilian, one Frenchman. The final of the 800 metres, and Guimaraes of Brazil has gone storming off.
Seb ran a ridiculous race. I don't know what he was doing in the race. He didn't know where to position himself, he didn't know what to do, didn't know where to go. He was just utterly kind of bemused.
54.5, slow time, left to the sprinters. Guimaraes, Brazil leads. And Coe now has got himself in trouble right at the back. Steve Ovett, those blue eyes like chips of ice. Steve Ovett in second place, and Coe's got an awful lot to do. He's coming from a long way back. Kirov leads, Ovett second. Coe is beaten surely. Steve Ovett coming home to take the gold medal for Great Britain to beat Sebastian Coe against the silver. And Ovett looks up in triumph. That was a race about experience.
Ovett stole the race, really. Didn't run great. Ran 3 seconds slower than Seb's world record and stole the race the day and became Olympic champion.
I sort of made the right moves at the right time. I didn't make mistakes. I think I was very conscious of that. Don't make a mistake in the final. Just relax, take it easy. And when the occasion arose, I just went and kicked as hard as I could. That was it. Now the stamp of approval was on Steve Ovett. You know, you are an Olympic champion. You are a good athlete. Well done, Steve. And I wanted to go home.
It was lack of experience. And I think that manifested itself by getting too nervous. And I just wish I'd done it in the Yorkshire Championships and not in Moscow. I just told myself, never ever in your career again walk away from a track feeling the way you did.
But it didn't end there. 6 days later, they'd meet again in the final of the 1500 metres.
The whole of the country, the whole of the nation, the world, athletic pundits everywhere, and athletes had written him off.
I just told myself, statistically, the chances of you running so badly again are very remote. I hadn't worked for 10 years. I hadn't run twice a day, sometimes three times a day. I hadn't lifted tons of weights. I hadn't done all the things I'd done for 10 years. For it suddenly to mean nothing.
Ovett had won the 800 metres. Coe had it all to prove in the 1500. Now, sequels are never as good as the original, are they? Or are they?
The 1500 metres Olympic final. Straub on the inside, going away and holding the curb. Sebastian Coe comes across from the outside, and Steve Ovett tracking Sebastian Coe. And again, it is a reluctant pace.
So we got through the first two laps very, very slowly, and then Jürgen almost looked down at the track to a mark.
Now Straub can't wait any longer. He knows the Britons have got the finish, so he's got to go.
He didn't just kick away and explode over five or six paces. He just steadily and incrementally made the pace a little bit quicker. And he was trying to get rid of both myself and Steve.
And look at Sebastian Coe there, checking where Ovett is, and Ovett's watching him all the way. Can they outsprint each other? Which one is the faster? And there goes Coe. He's looking for Ovett, wondering where he is. He's right there behind him.
There is that moment where you've been through the gears and there are no other gears. You've really just... I just thought, that's it. And if anybody comes at me now, I'm running quick, but I can't respond.
Could this be Ovett's first defeat? Ovett is in trouble, and Coe gets the revenge he wants. Second is Straub, third is Ovett.
The emotion at the end wasn't ecstasy or excitement, it was just the relief of having held on to that last 30 metres.
When Steve went to put his foot down on the accelerator, when you've got a gold medal in your pocket from the 800 from 3-4 days earlier, perhaps the hunger was not as strong as it was for Seb.
When I crossed the line, I didn't actually realise that Steve hadn't got the silver. I thought he'd actually nicked the silver and was much closer.
I was so expecting that Ovett had won the race. And actually, as I crossed the line, Seb was prostrate on the ground, and I tapped him on the back and said, tough luck, never mind. And as I turned around a few seconds later, I saw him with his arms in the air, and I thought, oh, you idiot, you know. But I hadn't seen them cross the line, because I was 50 yards behind.
The race, it wasn't a physical race for Seb Coe that day. It was a mental race. It was Seb Coe against the world. And if he didn't win that day, he wouldn't be Lord Coe now.
In Moscow, there were doubts that Sebastian Coe would even make it to Los Angeles to defend his 1500-metre title.
By the time I got to Los Angeles, I'd had a year and a half of very frustrating running. I'd had a blood problem. I'd had niggling injuries. And even in the... I had to run off in 84 against Peter Elliott to get a place in the 1500 metres, so I didn't know until very late on whether I was even going to make the team.
The press had heavily criticised his selection, but Coe proved his pedigree by taking silver in the 800 metres. And when it came to the 1500, there were some familiar faces out to deprive him of a great Olympic double.
Olympic 1500 metres final, and straight away Coe goes into the lead, determined not to get boxed. Bathgal, this dangerous Spaniard coming round now, tracked by the Olympic champion Sebastian Coe.
And the bell sounds, a Bathgal from Spain was leading, and on his shoulder there was Coe, Cram and Ovett. And I thought, you know, we'll never see this again, this will not happen again. Suddenly, it all fell apart. Steve Ovett stepped off the track. He couldn't get his breath. It was too hot and too oppressive.
And Steve Ovett's dropped out. It's not surprising. The world record holder out. It's been a bad week for him.
And then down the back straight, Steve Cram got ready to sprint.
The race really on now. There goes the world champion.
Seb preempted it. And just went and blew him away.
He's the Olympic champion. Can he do it again? Steve Cram in second place, champion of the world, follows him. Cram digs in, and Coe comes away to retain the Olympic title. Sebastian Coe, back at his best, is the Olympic champion again. And he's done what he did in Moscow 4 years ago. The silver in the 800, the gold in the 1500.
Suddenly, I just turned to a section of the British press. My exact words were, yes, perhaps you'll believe me now.
Seb was there defending his title, becoming the most successful British athlete in history by winning two gold medals in the 1500 metres and two silver medals in the 800 metres in those two Olympics.